I'm an associate professor of medicine at McGill University and McGill University Health Center. My global research program, which is based in India, South Africa, and also in Canada, is focused on developing innovative screening strategies with point-of-care technologies. We have to get that 15 to 25% people that do not know their status, so that we can bring this epidemic to its knees, right? To do so, we need to think out of the box. So there are many ways in which a person can get testing in Canada. The classic way is the standard lab of lab-based testing. You also have, you know, you have the anonymized testing option, you have the nominal testing option. But these are all connected to the central labs. Fair enough. You have a great system of public health labs, and they do a great job. But the problem is that they're always located in big cities, right? So there's sometimes an oversaturation of people seeking testing in some of these cities. Like in some of my studies I've seen in Montreal, there are people who come time and again, and they've sought testing at 3 or 4 centers. So there's an over catchment of these same kinds of patients that you're trying to recruit in your studies to offer them testing. What we need to do is to, so the lab-based testing modalities have not, they are great, but they're not available 24/7. The sample needs to be shipped, and there is a turnaround time associated with getting the results back to the patients. And when patients are from marginalized communities, they're not going to come back to the facilities in time. So they often don't get the results of their tests back to the patients. And it's nobody's fault. Everybody's trying to do a good job, but it somehow gets lost in the system. And so there's always a loss to follow up. And this may not happen in all the centers within Canada, but it certainly does happen. So there is a need for accessible technologies. There's a need for rapid technologies. There's a need for giving results, preliminary results, even though they are not definitive, but preliminary results. And therein comes the role of point of care testing. Point of care testing is a well-established method. It's known globally to work. The caveat with point of care testing, I mean, it allows you the engagement, you know, the benefit of engaging people and patients and clients or end users, whatever you may call them, or participants. They like that engagement because they are nervous. We can get the results faster to the patient. We can also encourage them to get linked to care, because getting a diagnosis is not enough. You've got to get them back into care. Now, point of care testing in Canada has never taken off, right? And there could be several reasons for it. Of course, there's a very well-established public health and network system of public health labs. There are regional and provincial, you know, health is a regional and provincial issue. So each province has its own system in place. Although we have fantastic evidence, and there's been scoping reviews done by our REACH team, that, you know, there have been major point of care testing projects in about 10 cities across Canada. They've shown that, you know, they reach people, they are feasible, acceptable, they impact detection. Somehow, these projects have not been scaled, you know. They haven't gone towards like a federal scale up, or that probably will never happen, but an interprovincial scale up. So like I said, point of care testing has not taken off, and that has impacted self-testing. HIV self-testing is defined as a process where an end user or a client buys a self-test, purchases a self-test, conducts this test in the convenience of a private space, interprets the result, right, records the result, and hopefully calls the counselor for linkages. Most self-tests come with a 1-800 toll-free number that can be called upon for care, for counseling and care. Now, the first self-test that was approved by the FDA Blood Products Committee way back in 2012, it was a huge, you know, it kind of catalyzed the entire field of self-testing. I don't think the FDA Blood Products Committee knew where this is going to go. And every year since 2012, you know, self-testing and HIV self-testing as a field has grown by leaps and bounds. I think HIV self-testing as a concept has arrived. HIV self-testing strategies need to be figured out for different contexts, different populations, different settings. And Africa has certainly been leading the way. So there is no way that this is not going to happen in Canada, because there's so much of a need, there's so much of a demand from communities, and there's so many resources to tap into. All we need to do is to connect the dots and figure out how we can offer it to people in the best possible way. We need to have more self-tests, and there are about 3 to 4 approved in UK, US, France, Netherlands. We need to provide people with different choices. We have choices for bags, for shoes, for boots, you know, for coats, for parkas. We need more choices for something that is as basic as a test and a self-test. The reason why I say that is because we don't want to create an Air Canada of self-tests. We need to have choices. We need to have choices for different pockets. Everybody, one of the reasons why the self-test did not take off in US was because it was marked at $40. $40. If you buy it on Amazon, and I've looked up these prices, it can go all the way up to $60 to $80. I think that's an insane amount of money for something. As a public health professional, you know, my heart is always for the communities. It's an insane amount of money to spend on a self-test, right? So we need to keep them at an affordable cost. And I think that those negotiations need to happen. And then we need to certainly set up these linkage systems and service delivery models where people with a positive result can get linked to care, and they're not stressing out in their homes or in their offices, isolated and stressed out about their test result. Because it's at the end of the day, it still is, even though it's highly accurate, it still could be either a false positive or a false negative. And we worry about both of them. I think the good news is we can expect an HIV self-test in Canada. I will not be able to comment on the timeline, but we are all very excited and we are working to make that a reality. We hope that at the end of 2018 or early 2019, we should have some approved, at least one approved self-test in Canada. So point of care tools, you know, point of care CD4 tests, fantastic for helping, you know, stage and monitor the progress. Point of care viral load assays have come out in the market. So there's incredible functionality built around it. We also have point of care biomarker, DNA and RNA based tests. So there's so much happening in the field that I think, you know, it's kind of hard to fathom as to where it's going to go in the next 10 years. So we better start integrating them so that we don't get left behind, because it's great to have confirmatory testing with using your labs, but it's always good to have additional backup options. And I think point of care testing is an excellent backup option. In terms of policies, there are about 40 countries that have policies that are in support of self-testing. In fact, the countries that don't have policies are actually scrambling to get something. And the biggest turnaround came with WHO's 2016 recommendations that said that, you know, clearly that, and some of us were part of those, you know, part of that process, that self-testing is an alternative to conventional testing, and it could be considered as an alternative strategy. We just need to have approved self-tests. There are about 12 prototypes that are, there are quite a few, 3 to 4 that I'm aware of that are pretty good, have solid evidence, right? And they are approved in countries like UK, France, Netherlands, Italy, Latvia. They all have approved self-tests. There are countries like Brazil and Thailand that have programs in place. And so I think the need of the hour is to really introduce that as an alternative strategy with, of course, linkages to care, which can be set up. And we have evidence that it can be, you know, worked upon. And with integration within the existing models of service delivery that is already in place. You can encourage behavior change in providers, you know, to accept point of care testing. The biggest barrier to acceptance of point of care testing is integration of point of care testing within the lab systems. And lab systems need to embrace them as that extra tool that expands their functionality and gets the patients that they've always wanted. So it's just an alternative. It's just one of those extended arms, like a robotic arm that helps them get those extra patients. And who wouldn't want that? Everybody wants that, right? So herein comes the role of innovation and disruption. So we need innovation to disrupt the status quo, and that will help catalyze and bring more patients into care. And that's all we want. We want people who are living with undiagnosed HIV or Hep C to get into care. That's how we can control infection in Canada. So it wouldn't just be 90, 90, 90. My dream is that it should actually be 100, 100, 100, you know, in about 10 years. And I don't think, you know, it's an impossible reality. I think it's totally possible.